Good morning, students. Today's topic is outbreeding devices. Okay, now when we talk about self-pollination, when we talk about pollination, we know there are two types of pollination. One is self-pollination, another one is cross-pollination. What is self-pollination? When the pollen grains and stigma, they belong to the same bisexual flower, and the pollen grains are released from the anther and deposit on the stigma of the same flower, that particular type of pollination is known as self-pollination. Or if the pollen grains are coming from the anthers of different flowers of the same plant, okay, and if they are getting deposited on the stigma of the different flower belonging to the same plant, that particular pollination can also be called as self-pollination. Ultimately, pollen grains and the stigma, if they belong to the same plant, if the pollination is happening between them, that type of pollination is known as self-pollination. Whereas, with respect to cross-pollination, when the pollen grains are coming from anther of different flowers of a different plant and they are getting deposited on the stigma of another flower of another plant, that type of pollination is known as cross pollination. Which is best for the plants? Okay, there is no argument that which pollination is best. However, sometimes what happens is in few flowering plants, continuous self-pollination leads to inbreeding depression. Okay, when a plant is undergoing continuous self-pollination, the plant will experience something called as inbreeding depression. Plants do not like it when the pollen grains are coming from the same flower of the same plant. Okay, so the plant attain something or experience something called as inbreeding depression. Inbreeding means the pollen grains and stigma belonging to the same flower, and the pollen grains are coming and depositing on the stigma of the same flower. The male gamete belonging to that particular pollen grain fertilizing the egg of the same pistil or carpel belonging to the same flower. The plants do not like it, and that condition is known as inbreeding depression. Okay, hence in order to avoid self-pollination, plants have developed certain techniques so that they can discourage the self-pollination and encourage the cross-pollination. Okay, few plants have developed certain techniques which we call as devices so that they can encourage cross-pollination and discourage self-pollination. These devices are known as outbreeding devices. Certain devices used by the plants to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. That is, the plants are more interested in cross-pollination than self-pollination. Few plants want to avoid self-pollination and they want cross-pollination to happen in them. That is, they want pollen grains to come from a different plant rather than the pollen grains are coming from the same plant. Okay. Now, what is the benefit of cross-pollination when compared to self-pollination? The benefit of cross-pollination is that they lead to genetic variability. That means if the pollen grains are coming from a different plant, okay, there is a chance that there is some kind of genetic variation in the male gamete which is coming inside the, which is present inside the pollen grain, and when they fertilize the egg present inside the pistil, the new combination of genes coming in that particular male gamete will combine with the existing genes which is present inside the female gamete, and there is a possibility of a new genetic variation or a new genetic possibility appearing in that particular zygote. Okay, when the zygotes are formed, the zygote will be formed with a new with a genetic variability or new any particular special character. Okay, that is the reason plants prefer cross-pollination when compared to self-pollination. So, in order to avoid self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination, plants have developed certain devices. Devices, when we say, kind of techniques. Plants themselves, they have developed certain techniques so that self-pollination happens in the plant and self-pollination doesn't happen and cross-pollination happens. Which are those devices? We have to study four important outbreeding devices. This question is also very important according to your NCERT syllabus, and this is generally asked in your question paper for 2 marks or 3 marks. First outbreeding device is that in the previous classes we have discussed, when the anther dehisces and releases pollen grains, at the particular time the stigma which is present close to this anther should be receptible, so that as soon as the pollen grains are released from the anther, stigma captures those pollen grains. Okay, there is a continuous dialogue happening between the stigma and the pollen grains, or the pistil and the pollen grains, and these pollen grains are received by the stigma. Pollen grains eventually produces pollen tube and the pollination and fertilization happens. Okay, now whenever the anthers are released from whenever the pollen grains are released from the anther, at the same time the stigma should be a receptible stigma. That means the stigma should be ready to receive the pollen grains. This phenomenon is called as synchronization. Okay, there is a synchronization. Two things happening together. Pollen grains are getting released from the anther, stigma becoming receptible. Okay, so there is a synchronization between these two processes. Only then those pollen grains will be able to carry out for pollination on that particular stigma. Imagine there is no synchronization between the pollen release and the stigma receptivity. Okay, when there is no synchronization between pollen grains released from the anther and the receptivity of the stigma, then definitely self-pollination will not happen. This is the first technique used by a plant in order to avoid self-pollination. What happens is, no synchronization in there is no synchronization in stigma receptivity and pollen release. Okay, here what could happen is the pollen grains are released much before the stigma become receptible, or the stigma becomes receptible, you know, even before the pollen grains are released from the anther. Okay, at that particular time, both the phenomenon are not matching, and there is a very less chance that the pollen grains will carry out pollination on that particular stigma. Okay, so this is the first technique used by plants in order to avoid self-pollination. Okay, there is no synchronization between pollen grain release and the stigma receptivity. Now, the second outbreeding devices is that the stigma and the anthers are located far from each other so that they do not meet. Okay, however, in a bisexual flower, if this is the pistil and this is the stigma, generally anthers are closely located to this pistil, okay, or the stamens are closely located to the pistil. When the stamen and pistil are closely located, there is always a chance that as soon as the pollen grains are released from this anther, it will deposit on the stigma and the pollination happens. However, imagine if this stamen are not very close to the pistil, or the anthers are located far away from the stigma, or in a different position when compared to stigma. At this particular situation, self-pollination will not happen. There is a less possibility that the self-pollination will happen in this particular case. Okay, so this is the second outbreeding device or technique used by the plants to avoid self-pollination. Okay, so what is the second technique used by the plants? Stigma and anthers are located at different position. They may not meet each other. The anther and stigma may not meet each other so that the pollination can happen easily. Okay, in this case also a plant can avoid self-pollination. This technique is also known as one of the outbreeding devices. Okay, third is self-incompatibility. Okay, the third device used by the plants in order to avoid self-pollination is that self-incompatibility. Self-incompatibility is a genetic mechanism where self-pollens are not allowed to produce pollen tube. Okay, so the third technique is called a self-incompatibility. It's a genetic mechanism where a flower or in particularly the pistil is capable enough of knowing where the pollen grains are coming from. If the flower knows that the pollen grain belongs to this particular plant, my own plant, then those pollen grains will not be allowed to produce a pollen tube. Okay? Even though the pollen grains are coming and depositing on the stigma belonging to the same flower, both belonging to the same flower, the pistil the flower itself has a knowledge that this pollen is a self pollen. That means it belongs to me. It belongs to this particular flower, this particular plant. Such pollens will not be allowed to produce pollen tube on the surface of stigma. When the pollen tubes are not produced, there is no pollination and fertilization happening. In this case also, a plant can avoid self-pollination. Okay, the plant will accept only the pollens coming from different plant, whereas the self-pollens will be rejected by the plants. The last device used by used by the plant in order to avoid self-pollination is they produce unisexual flowers. Okay, when a plant is producing unisexual flower, it is a very simple technique of a plant. If the plant doesn't want the pollen grains to come from the same plant, then what the plant does, they will produce unisexual flower. Either the flower is it carries antrisium or gynoecium, either the male reproductive part or the female reproductive part, then there is no threat of the self pollens coming and getting deposited to the stigma. Okay, the plants produce unisexual flowers. This is the last outbreeding device used by the plant to avoid self pollination. So what is outbreeding device? Few plants, when they do not like self-pollination to happen, when they encourage cross-pollination so that genetic variability can appear, such plants, what they do is, they develop certain techniques in order to avoid self-pollination. Such techniques are known as outbreeding devices. Okay, so devices here means to certain techniques used by the plants. So such techniques are: no synchronization in stigma receptivity, there is no synchronization between stigma receptivity and pollen release. The time of stigma becoming receptible and the pollen release are not matching. Okay, so the pollen grains will go as a waste, or if the pollen grains are carried through wind or water or through animals to some other plant, then the pollination can happen in another plant. Okay, the second one is stigma and anthers are located at different positions. If the stigma and anthers are not coming close to each other, if they are at completely different location, there is a chance that self-pollination can be avoided. The last one is self-incompatibility. That means it is a genetic mechanism developed by the plant itself, where plant rejects the self-pollens, the pollen coming from the same plant, and it will accept only the pollens coming from different plants. The last is plants produce unisexual flowers. Okay, then there is no risk of self-pollination here. Hope this topic is clear to you. So now we know that there are four post-fertilization events. The events taking place after the fertilization is completed. So there are four post-fertilization events. The first one, as I have already mentioned in my previous classes, ovary develops into a fruit. Ovule develops into a seed, zygote develops into an embryo, and primary endosperm cell, which is also represented as PEC, they give rise to endosperm tissue. Okay, endosperm is nothing but a nutritive tissue which gives nourishment to the developing embryo. Okay, in the previous classes we have studied what is endosperm, how endosperm is produced from the primary endosperm cell, what is a free nuclear endosperm, what is a cellular endosperm, okay, and what is the function of endosperm. In today's class, we will be dealing with the topic embryo, how embryo is developed from the zygote. Embryo is nothing but young sporophytic plant developed from zygote. Okay, we know that there is inside the embryo sac, when the female gamete fuses with the male gamete, it leads to a fusion called a syngamy. As a result of syngamy, a zygote is formed, which is diploid. Okay, the male gamete and female gamete both are haploid. When they fuse with each other, it leads to a diploid cell, which is known as zygote. And the zygote ultimately it develops into embryo. Embryo is nothing but a young sporophytic plant. Okay, again developed from zygote. Okay, when embryo is developed from a single-celled diploid zygote, this process is known as embryogeny, or it is also known as embryogenesis. Okay, embryogeny is a process where zygote develops into a embryo. When a zygote develops into an embryo, embryo is formed. This process is known as embryogeny, generation of embryo, okay, or the formation of embryo. Now, as a first topic, we know that there are two types of plants, dicotyledons and monocotyledons. Okay, in the first case, we will look into the structure and the development of dicot embryo. We will first see how a dicot embryo is formed from a single cell zygote. Okay, later we will look into how a monocot embryo is formed and what is the structure of a monocot embryo. In this topic, we will also study the structure of a dicot embryo. Here in this case, I have drawn the structure of an embryo sac, which we will find inside an ovule. Okay, I have not mentioned primary endosperm cell or the endosperm tissue, antipodals, because we are only concerned about a zygote here. Okay, since we are studying about the topic embryo, we need to know where, how the embryo is formed and who is developing the embryo. Now, here, as we all know, the zygote, which is a fertilized egg, which is diploid in nature, is going to produce embryo in the future. That is the reason I have drawn the picture of only one zygote inside the embryo sac. Here, the very important thing to notice, and you should always remember, is that whenever you are drawing an embryo sac, or whenever you are drawing the structure of an anatropous ovule, you have to mention which end you are representing to. Okay, if always the bottom part is always represented as micropylar end, doesn't matter whichever angle, whichever side you draw the shape of the ovule or embryo sac, you have to make sure that the particular structure belongs to the particular pole. For example, egg apparatus always belongs to micropylar pole, whereas antipodals always belongs to chalicial end. Okay, the antipodals always belongs to chalicial pole and this egg apparatus always belongs to micropylar end. You can draw it in an inverted fashion also. However, again the micropylar end should go up and the chalicial end should come up. Always mention M and C so that it represent micropylar end, chalicial end. Now, since we are concerned about embryogenesis, I am taking out only the zygote part from this embryo sac so that we can study how from a zygote a complete embryo is formed. Okay, so I am drawing this picture of zygote here. clarify here that till now I have been drawing the structure of ovule, I have been drawing the structure of embryo sac, where micropylar pole I have been representing this side, okay, in the bottom portion, and chalazal end I was representing here in the upper part. Okay, be specific and try to note that here, from here onwards, I will be drawing the structure of zygote and also all the embryos, you know, where I will be representing micropylar end here, okay, and the chalazal end here. The only reason I'm doing this here is because it is very convenient for us to understand the structure of the embryo. If I draw the consider micropylar end at this side and the chalazal end at this side, okay, there is no other particular reason. Okay, after the end of the diagram, again I will mention, I will explain you the structure of embryo inside the embryo sac, where micropylar end comes here this side itself and the chalazal end comes this side itself. Okay, so now this is a zygote. Please note, I am writing the micropylar end on the other side and the chalazal end here. Okay, now zygote is a diploid cell. Zygote always undergoes mitosis. Okay, we all know that meiosis is a reduction division which is usually carried out only during the formation of gametes. Since there is no formation of gametes here, there is no meiosis, the division happening here is only mitosis. When the zygote undergoes a mitotic division, what happens is we get two cells. Okay, when a zygote undergoes a mitotic division, it is an equational division, we get two cells, both the cells are diploid. Okay, now in these two cells, now we cannot call it as a zygote anymore. Now I'll name these two cells. Here the cell which is towards the micropylar end, this cell is known as basal cell. Okay, whereas the cell which is towards the chalazal end, this is known as terminal cell. This cell can also be called as apical cell. Okay, so here when the zygote undergoes mitotic division, we get two diploid cells here. Okay, the upper cell which is towards the micropylar end is known as basal cell and the lower cell which is towards the chalazal end, we call them as terminal cell or the apical cell. Now what happens here is there are two different types of division happening. Okay, basal cell undergoes their own division, its own division, whereas the terminal or cell also undergoes its own division. What happens exactly is that the basal cell undergoes a transverse division. Okay, kindly look into this carefully. The basal cell undergoes a transverse division where it produces 6 to 10 cell long structure. Okay, a structure containing almost 6 to 10, here I have drawn 6 cells. Okay, 6 to 10 celled long structure which is known as suspensor. Okay, zygote undergoes a mitotic division to produce two cells, basal and terminal cell. Basal cell in turn undergoes transverse section and produce a long structure which has almost 6 to 10 cells in it. This structure is known as suspensor, towards this end of the suspensor, towards the end, there is a large, almost circular cell. This cell is represented as haustorium is present. Okay, basal cell undergoes a transverse division where it produces a long structure known as suspensor, which is almost 6 to 10 cell longer, and at the end of the suspensor there is a circular large cell known as haustorium. Okay, so that is the ultimate result of basal cells division. Now terminal cells also undergoes normal mitotic division. The terminal cells also undergoes, here let us represent terminal cell in different colors so that it will be easy for you to understand. Okay, I will make it green. Now the terminal cells also undergoes normal mitotic division. Where it initially produces two cell, okay? Initially terminal cell is one cell, it produces two cell, then the four cell, then the eight cell, part of this particular structure. Here I have drawn a structure where there are two cells. Initially you imagine there were two cells, then the two cells divided and produced four cells. Now these four cells have divided and produced eight cells. Okay, such structure, this particular structure is produced from this terminal cell. Now the structure is referred as proembryo. Now the structure is known as proembryo. Okay, there is a suspensor attached to it, there is a haustorium cell, and there is a proembryo, which is formed as a result of division from terminal cell. Okay, now the same structure again develops where there is haustorium. Okay, there is suspensor and embryo. Here you can find that surrounding to this embryo we have radially arranged cells as well as longitudinally arranged cells also. Okay, they are individual cells. They are individual cells. Now this structure, okay, with multiple number of cells here, can be called as globular embryo because it is in the globular shape. Okay, so this is haustorium, this is suspensor, and the whole structure is known as globular embryo. Initially there was a single cell zygote which divided into two cells, upper basal and the lower terminal cell. Basal cell undergoes division to produce a structure called a suspensor which has a haustorium at the end. Then there is a embryo, particular embryo form, which this structure is known as proembryo because it is still not a mature embryo. Then again this part of the proembryo again undergoes mitotic division to produce another some more developed embryo known as globular embryo. Again this globular embryo undergoes mitotic division forming a heart-shaped embryo. Okay, the globular embryo again undergoes multiple mitotic division and it leads to another some more mature embryo, which is known as heart-shaped embryo. Heart-shaped embryo again undergoes few more mitotic division and it forms one more shape of the embryo, which is generally known as horseshoe shape. Since it is not mentioned in your syllabus, I am skipping that horseshoe shaped embryo and I will be drawing the final mature embryo here. In the final mature embryo, the haustorium and the suspensor are not clearly visible. They are not as prominent as it is seen in proembryo and globular embryo. We cannot write the individual cells. Okay, that is the reason I am representing, I am drawing this way. Okay, so this is the structure of a mature embryo. Okay, these structures could be drawn when they ask you embryogenesis in your exams. Okay, if embryogenesis is asked, you can draw these diagrams where you can mention one zygote, the zygote develops into a basal cell and terminal cell. Please remember to mention micropylar end and the chalazal end so that you don't have any confusion in understanding the structure. Now from zygote we have these two cell stage, then we have proembryo, globular embryo, heart-shaped embryo. Ultimately it leads to this mature embryo. Okay, mature embryo in this part, it has a plumule. In a mature embryo, in this part, we have radical, or which is represented as root tip. Here we have plumule, which is represented as shoot tip. And we have, since it is a dicotyledon, we have two cotyledons here, Okay, so this is the structure of a mature embryo. Again in detail I will be drawing the structure of a typical dicot embryo, which is again important for your final exam, which is again important for your exams. Okay, again remember I will be drawing the clean structure of a dicot embryo, which would be drawn in the examination. This is the whole process of embryogenesis. Now here you see the structure of the suspensor and the haustorium is not prominent as it is seen in the earlier stages of the embryo. Now this is the micropylar end, this is the chalazal end. Now you should be knowing this is micropylar end and this is chalazal end. So when the zygote develops into a embryo, how does it look? So if I draw this mature embryo, inside the embryo sac where zygote was present, now it is no more a zygote because they have developed into a mature embryo. Since this is the micropylar end and this is the chalazal end, now you can revert the whole diagram. Okay, now you can revert it so that the micropylar end again comes here and the chalazal end goes to that side. Okay, always remember embryogenesis happens in the micropylar end of the ovule, not towards the chalazal core. Okay, now you have this haustorium here, and the suspensor here and the matured embryo here. Now we might be having a question, why do we need these haustorium and the suspensor? Okay, the function of the suspensor is that it pushes the embryo or the developing embryo towards this side of the embryo sac, so that you know in this part of the embryo sac from the primary endosperm cell, endosperm tissue have developed and endosperm tissue have lot of reserve food material so that they can give nourishment to the developing embryo. Since the endosperm is carrying nutrition for the developing embryo, the function of the suspensor is that suspensor keeps pushing the embryo towards the endosperm tissue so that the developing embryo gets sufficient nutrition from the endosperm tissue. Okay, so its function is to push the embryo towards endosperm tissue to get proper nutrition. This is the concept of embryogenesis. Now we will look into the structure of a dicot embryo. Okay, it looks almost similar to this. However, I will draw it as a separate topic. Okay, this is a very simple structure of a dicot embryo. Okay, the name itself indicates it's a dicotyledon. That means it must be having two cotyledons. Where are the two cotyledons? These two are the cotyledons present in a dicot embryo. A dicot, simple dicot embryo has two parts in it, two cotyledons. As I have mentioned, these are the two cotyledons of a dicot embryo and it has a embryonal axis, which is this part of the embryo. They have two cotyledons and they have a embryonal axis. Okay, now there are few more parts which are very important in this diagram, which I will mention here. Now this part, okay, here you see this part, this part is known as level of cotyledons. So this is one cotyledon, this is one cotyledon. Okay, so this part is known as the level of cotyledons. Okay, because the cotyledons are present almost till here. Okay, now the part above the level of these two cotyledons, the portion of the embryo above the level of these two cotyledons is known as epicotyle. Okay, so I hope it is clear to you. The part of the embryo or the portion of the embryo above the level of these two cotyledons are known as epicotyle, and the portion of the embryonal axis which is below this level of two cotyledons or dicotyledons are known as hypocotyle. The portion of this embryonal axis which is above the level of two cotyledons are known as epicotyle. The portion of embryonal axis which is below the level of this dicotyledons are known as hypocotyle. In this part of the epicotyle ends with this part which is known as plumule. Okay, epicotyle ends with this region known as plumule, which is generally represented as stem tip. Okay, because it is going to give rise to stem in a flowering plant. Okay, now this part of the embryonal axis is known as hypocotyle. This ends with a tip here known as radicle, which is generally represented as root tip, because this is going to generate roots or form roots in a angiospermic plant. Okay, so now these are the two cotyledons. This is the embryonal axis. The portion of the embryonal axis above the level of cotyledons are known as epicotyle. Below the level of cotyledons are known as hypocotyle. Hypocotyle ends with radicle, which is again going to give rise to root tip in the future. This part is known as epicotyle, which is going to give rise to, you know, which ends with plumule. This region, this is going to give rise to stem in a flowering plant. Okay, now this part of the embryonal axis where there is this radicle, it ends with a small structure known as root cap. Okay, so we all know that at the root tip there is a protective cap to the root, which is known as root cap. This part of the embryonal axis or the embryo is that particular root cap. So this is the ultimate structure of a dicot embryo, which has two cotyledons, one embryonal axis, and it has two parts to the embryonal axis: epicotyle, which ends with plumule, which is going to give rise to stem in the future, and the hypocotyle, which is ending with radicle or root tip, okay, and which is also covered by a root cap. Okay, so this is all about how embryogenesis happened and what is the structure of dicot embryo. In next class, we will be studying about the structure of a monocot embryo. Hope this class is clear to all of you.